In this lecture, we are going to look at transcription. At the end of the lecture, you will be able to describe how an enzyme, RNA polymerase, copies the information from a DNA into a messenger mRNA. And this is known as the transcription process. Next week, we will look at how this messenger RNA is then translated into proteins. The central dogma of molecular biology. This is how information flows in the cells. Information that is found in the DNA can be replicated into another DNA. Or the information in the DNA can be transcribed or can be copied or can be encoded onto a messenger RNA. The messenger RNA can then be translated or decoded to make proteins. So transcription is a process of making messenger RNA from DNA. DNA has two strands. It's a double-stranded molecule. So one of the strands, only one of the strands, will be used as a template to make messenger RNA. Then the messenger RNA will then be translated to make proteins. So that is translation process. So the messenger mRNA will copy the information from the DNA with the help of a enzyme and then carry the message to make proteins. This slide gives you an overview of transcription and translation. As you can see, you have a double-stranded DNA and we have an enzyme here, RNA polymerase, that attaches to the double-stranded DNA. This polymerase is then going to copy the genes. These are the genes, A, B, C, and D. It's going to copy the genes into a messenger RNA. This messenger RNA is then going to bring the message from the nucleus into the cytoplasm, where it will be translated into proteins. We're going to look at the components that are necessary for the transcription process. First, you need a DNA. So, a DNA template, a double-stranded DNA. Only one of the strands, for example, if you look at it here, this strand, only one of the strands is going to be used as a template to make the messenger RNA. Next, we need transcription factors and enhancers. Transcription factors are proteins that help to turn on specific genes or to turn them off for gene expression. So they regulate the gene expression process. So what are enhancers? So enhancers are additional regions that help to increase or enhance transcription. So these are molecules that either increase or decrease the rate of gene expression. So by doing this, they regulate the amount of RNA molecules that can be produced. If there's a need for a lot of proteins, so they will increase or speed up the transcription process, so more RNA molecules will be produced. So, but these enhancers, they are not necessarily close to the genes they enhance. The enhancers can be upstream of the gene. So, upstream means somewhere here, upstream of the gene, or can be downstream of the gene, somewhere here. Okay, next we need a promoter region. A promoter region guides the enzyme where it should start transcription. So the RNA polymerase binds to the promoter region before it starts transcription. And we need triphosphate ribonucleotides. These are your bases: adenine, uracil, guanine, and cytosine bases that you need to make your mRNA. And finally, you need the enzyme RNA polymerase. So this enzyme copies the message encoded in the DNA into a RNA molecule. So these are the 5 main components that you need for transcription. So what happens when transcription starts? So DNA is double-stranded, okay, and is antiparallel. One goes from 5 prime to 3 prime end. Another strand goes from 3 prime to 5 prime end. Only one of these 2 strands is used as a template to make messenger RNA. So the RNA polymerase, that's the enzyme that's going to carry out the transcription. So the RNA polymerase reads the DNA from the 3 prime to the 5 prime end. So this strand from the 3 prime to 5 prime is known as the template or non-coding strand. So the information on this strand is going to be used to make your RNA. The strand that is not used as a template is known as the coding strand. So this strand is not used to make your messenger RNA. So this transcription takes place in the nucleus in eukaryotic cells. So basically what happens is that the transcription factors bind to the promoter region and recruit the RNA polymerase to start transcription. So the RNA polymerase then reads the template strand to make a RNA. Now this RNA is not the messenger RNA, it is actually the heteronuclear RNA, or HN RNA. We'll talk about the messenger RNA in a short while, but transcription gives you heteronuclear RNA. So the RNA polymerase starts to transcribe from the 3 prime to 5 prime end of the DNA and copies the information to make a RNA molecule. Now the RNA grows from the 5 prime to 3 prime direction. So you look at it here, RNA starts from 5 prime and then it ends at 3 prime. Okay. So the RNA molecule transcribes the DNA until it reaches a stop or termination signal in the DNA. So it will keep on growing until it comes to a stop signal or a termination signal. This slide shows you the overall picture, or gives you a bird's eye view of the whole transcription process. So we have a double-stranded DNA. Okay, double-stranded DNA. It is now being transcribed. Transcription, okay, to make a HN RNA. This HN RNA will undergo these changes to become a mature mRNA, which can then be brought out of the nucleus to make protein. So this is the overall picture. So now, when transcription stops, when DNA is copied to a HN RNA, that's when the transcription process stops. After that, adding of 5 prime cap, poly A tail, RNA splicing, these are known as the post-transcriptional processes. We'll come to that in a short while. Now, in most eukaryotic genes, here, the eukaryotic genes are in your DNA, right? In most eukaryotic genes, you have the introns and the exons. Okay, so what are these? The exons, here, these are the exons. The exons are the regions or sequences that code for a protein. Okay, for example, all these blue lines are your exons, blue lines. All these yellow ones are your introns after transcription. Okay, so if you can see this here, all the exons are the blue lines. Now, eventually, only the blue lines are present for making proteins. Can you see that? All the yellow lines have been removed. Okay, so the coding regions, the regions in the DNA which actually code for a protein, these are known as the exons. The non-coding regions, these are the intervening regions, they are known as the introns. We'll come to this in more detail in a short while. So during transcription, all the information in the DNA, all the information in the DNA is copied onto your hnRNA. Everything. Okay? The introns and exons are copied into the pre-RNA. Or the heteronuclear RNA. During the process of post-transcriptional processing, the exons will be kept, okay, they'll be joined together, and the introns will be removed. Okay, we'll talk about the splicing in a short while. At the end of these post-transcription processes, you have a mature mRNA that is ready for translation. So let's look at the heterogeneous nuclear RNA or heteronuclear RNA, hnRNA. This is a pre-RNA transcript found only in the nucleus of eukaryotic cells. This hnRNA does not leave the nucleus. So it undergoes post-transcriptional processing and then it is then converted into a mature messenger RNA where it is used for translation in the cytoplasm. So now that the information from the DNA has been transcribed onto a hnRNA, okay, your pre-RNA. So this pre-RNA will now undergo post-transcriptional processing to become a mature messenger RNA, and the mature mRNA will leave the nucleus to the cytoplasm to make proteins. So to become a mature mRNA, the hnRNA will undergo modifications. Or we call them post-transcriptional processing in the nucleus before it can become a mature mRNA. So let's look at these processes. First, you have the capping. 7-methyl guanosine cap is attached to the 5' end of the hnRNA. So let's say this is your hnRNA. This is the 5' end. So you have a cap. This is your 7-methyl guanosine cap attached to the 5' end of the hnRNA. The function of this cap is to transport the RNA from nucleus to cytoplasm. It aids in the transportation, allows the mRNA to leave the nucleus to the cytoplasm. Another function of this cap: in the cytoplasm, the ribosomes look for this cap to start translation. The ribosomes attach to this cap and then they will start to translate the message in the mRNA into proteins. Another process is the polyadenylation at the 3' end of the hnRNA. So the 3' end of the hnRNA is cleaved. small section of the 3 prime end is cut off, removed, and then polyadenylation takes place, which means poly A tail is attached to the 3 prime end. So what is poly A tail? It is basically your adenine nucleotides. So your adenine nucleotides, ATUC, remember, adenine, guanine, cytosine, uracile. So the adenine nucleotides are added to the 3 prime end of the HNRNA, like that. So how many adenine molecules are added? About 200 to 250 bases of adenine molecules are added. So this poly A tail provides stability to the HNRNA molecule, and it also protects the RNA from degradation by nucleases found in the cytoplasm. So now, nucleases are enzymes that destroy nucleic acids. So if the RNA is protected by a poly A tail, it will not be degraded by the nucleases. Another function of the polyadenylation, it aids in the degradation of the RNA in the cytoplasm. When the RNA has been converted or has been used to make proteins, okay, what happens to the messenger RNA? It gets destroyed. Okay, so the poly A tail also aids in the destruction or degradation of messenger RNA in the cytoplasm after translation has taken place. Next, we look at splicing. Okay, as I mentioned in the earlier slides, DNA contains introns and exons. And these introns are exons are transcribed onto the HNRNA. So not all the regions in the HNRNA are used for making proteins. Okay, the introns are regions that are not necessary for protein making, and the regions that are necessary for protein making are known as your exons. So introns are intervening sequences which are not necessary for protein making. Exons are expressed sequences that are necessary to make proteins. So in splicing, the introns are spliced out. Okay, what I'm trying to say is that the splicing process removes the introns and joins all the exons together to give a continuous reading frame for translation. Okay, so the exons are then joined together to make a single continuous sequence. Okay, that can be used to make proteins. Now, splicing also plays a role in gene expression via alternate splicing. Alternate splicing means a single gene coding for multiple proteins. Okay, so alternative splicing, also known as differential splicing, is a regulated process during gene expression that results in a single gene, one gene, coding for multiple proteins. So in this process, particular exons of a gene may be included or excluded from the messenger mRNA to make proteins. So one gene, okay, because of the exon, some exons are included, some exons are removed, okay, can make multiple proteins. This is alternate splicing. So this slide shows you the RNA splicing process. As you can see, the HNRNA or the pre-mRNA contains both introns and exons. And during RNA splicing, the introns are removed and then the exons are joined together to make a continuous reading frame, which can then be used to make proteins. So the introns or the intervening sequences are not necessary for making proteins. The exons, referred to as the express sequences, are important for making proteins. Dr. Walter Gilbert, he was a Harvard biologist. He coined the terms exons and introns. The express sequences he called exons, and the regions in between, which the cell has to splice out, he called them introns. So here we see the whole process again. You have a DNA that is then transcribed into a HNRNA. Next, we have the post-transcriptional processes. This whole thing is the post-transcriptional processes. You have the 7-methylguanosine cap added to the 5 prime. And then you have the polyadenylation, poly cleavage first. A part of the 3 prime end is removed. And then the poly A is added here, poly A. Okay, this is polyadenylation. And then the introns are then spliced out. Okay, and finally, you have the mature messenger RNA. So these are the 3 post-transcriptional processes: capping, which is guanosine nucleotide added to the 5 prime end. Then you have polyadenylation, about 200 to 250 adenine nucleotides added to the 3 prime end. And then you have splicing. So these 3 processes result in a mature messenger RNA that is now ready to be used to make proteins. So we've come to the end of the lecture. So the transcription process: the DNA template carries the genetic code. There are 2 DNA strands. The 3 prime to 5 prime strand of the DNA is used as a template to make your mRNA or HNRNA. The RNA polymerase is an enzyme that transcribes these genetic information to a HNRNA. The HNRNA undergoes post-transcriptional processes, the capping, polyadenylation, and splicing to make a mature messenger RNA. This mature messenger RNA will then be translated to proteins. We will look at the process of translation in the next lecture.